Well, a collection of major deals announced today in the healthcare space. Danaher will buy GE's biopharma business, Life Sciences, for $21.4 billion. And Roche Holdings will buy Spark Therapeutics for $4.3 billion. Private equity firm Platinum Equity announced today it will buy label maker Multicolor Corporation for $2.5 billion. And mining company Barrick Gold has made an unsolicited offer to acquire Newmont in an all-share transaction. This bevy of deals catching the eye of at least one major investor. Gamco Investors chairman and CEO and co-author of Merger Masters, Tales of Arbitrage. Mario Gabelli joins us now via phone for a CNBC exclusive interview to discuss all of this deal-making activity. Welcome to the program, Mario. Appreciate you being here with us today. I would like to start first with the GE.
I hope to see you in person, Courtney, but I couldn't do it today.
Hey, we understand. We appreciate you being with us any way you can do it. Let's start with the GE Danaher deal. I understand, at least as of the end of last year, you own some of those Danaher shares, so you've got to be happy today. That stock popping on that news,
well,
about 8% or so.
Sometimes the buyer of the business stock goes down. Sometimes it goes up. In this particular deal, Danaher was up about $10, showing that they are focused on getting that recurring revenue. What we do as a firm, and I started this place about, I started doing research 50 years ago as a sell-side analyst, we do bottoms-up research. In the late 70s, I coined the phrase and trademarked it, private market value with a catalyst. What will narrow the gap between the public price and the narrow price? And arbitrage is an outgrowth of that. It's a very interesting way to earn an absolute return. And the arbitrageurs in our book, 19 or 18 of them, have done extremely well over an extended period of time when focusing on absolute return. Today was another example of a lot of deals surfacing. You touched on one or two. Just the notion of why should companies be allowed to do transactions and how does the free market work within that framework? How do managements allocate capital, right or wrong? We've seen some horrendous deals. Just think about how Hewlett Packard bought a company in the UK a few years ago, how Time Warner did AOL at the time, or AOL did Time Warner. But on the other side, there have been a significant number of well-done structural transactions, taking advantage of synergistic benefits at the corporate level. And then you've got the PE guys, and you got Warren Buffett doing elephant hunting. So, and then you get the price of the stocks of the targets, aside from the Newmont Barrick deal today, where they pay a big premium over less. So those are the elements that come together.
And Mario, given those elements, Mike Santoli, by the way, doesn't it seem as if where we are in the economic expansion, how far along we are, the credit markets remain very accommodating. Obviously, stock prices are high enough. CEOs should feel confident. Shouldn't we be seeing more Mondays like this with at least as many deals? And what do you make of the fact that deal activity as a percentage of, let's say, overall market cap has not really been that high given where we are in this bull market?
Well, you had enough transactions, Mike, last year that were probably the second or third best. I don't have the numbers in front of me. Independent of that, you go through cycles and transactions. Obviously, the CEOs of companies and the boards feel comfortable when there's a tailwind, okay? When there's a tailwind, whether it's USMCA or whether it's an EU transactions or a deal with China. But independent of that, companies want to grow. They look at their cost of capital. They look at the tax structures of deals. They look at any benefits that they get. And, what multiple are they paying? And then the PE guys look at what multiple will they be able to sell at 5 to 7 years from now. So what's Buffett looking at? What are the corporate entities looking at? And in the case of the three deals that you saw today, whether it was Spark Therapeutics or whether it was Clemencia or CAS Medical, Clementia, you would say to yourself, hey, what values does the buyer have? What do they need to accelerate growth? Was this R&D off the balance sheet? So those are the things, Mike.
Mario, earlier today, Warren Buffett seemed to suggest that while he still likes equities very long term, in the short term, it's quite hard to be buying. When we consider some of those macro factors like the Fed pivot, like a China trade deal seemingly closer, do you feel like all of that good news is already priced in into the markets at the moment?
Well, that's a different question. You got three different questions. One is, what is the market, is the China deal baked in? The market likes to discount 6 months in advance or some period in advance. And as you're looking at a likely deal with China months ago, you started saying, look, Trump positioned it well. It's like a CEO positioning the economy for a year from now so that he has a strong economy in the spring of 2020 when the election is running. And so the market, to a degree, has, and you've had multiples of EBITDA minus CapEx, however you want to value businesses, they have crept back up, particularly as small cap stocks. But there's still a lot of very interesting nuggets out there. For example, is Wind, now that they got the license in Everett in Massachusetts, will something happen to that company? Will the deal with the Chinese allow Macau to get the license renewals with greater expectation? So financial engineerings, will a company like Command spin off their industrial products business, as some have suggested? You know, and every day you have new opportunities.
Mario, earlier this morning, Warren Buffett hinted that he very nearly made a very large acquisition in Q4. You follow Mr. Buffett very closely. Any idea what you think that might have been, or is there any recommendation you'd have for him?
Not at all. One sentence, however, in his chairman's letter, which was kind of a lot of sentences, but one that was intriguing is he's saying for the first time more openly, aside from him being one of the best tax people around, along with John Malone, but he's more quiet about it. He's talking about non-U.S. What is he doing about saying, hey, maybe the bargains are outside the United States? Look, he's done very well with BYD, the Chinese electric vehicle manufacturer. He's done quite well with some German opportunities with Ishkar in Israel. So is he saying I can get a better multiple outside the United States? Read that last sentence. That kind of perked my interest.